So a few of our examples. The short hint, because I always get asked this question, how many humans do I need when I know nothing? Sometimes the basic element has to do more with stability of the estimating equation than with really solving the problem. So you may run one of these calculations that tells you only need 3 people per arm. You will need more than 3 people per arm. 15 people per arm, or rats per arm, et cetera, tend to be the minimum number. This is a good rule of thumb for early studies. Why is this? Well, when you have 12 to 15 values, you actually get a somewhat stable variance equation. I'm not saying it's right. It could be that you have weird sampling and the variance is off because of bias. But the equation itself for variance stabilizes between sometimes as low as 10, but usually 12 to 15 numbers in it. If you're using a Bayesian analysis technique, sometimes you need at least 70 people per arm before the analysis is in fact stable. A lot of our studies, a lot of our analyses and regressions float to something called a z-test. However, if you have a smaller sample size below 20 or 30, even sometimes below 100, you need to check a t-distribution. If you're doing something like logistic regression, principal components analysis, et cetera, you usually need a minimum of 10 participants per variable. These are individual participants per variable. And in some cases, you may need 100 per variable in order to get stable estimates. This is for the math will spew out of the computer. Doesn't mean the functions are stable. So there's this balance of wanting to find significant results. What do I need if I think these are the differences I'm aiming for? And then also, how many people do I need for the math to be sound? So now we're going to do, it's not truly a live statistical consult because I took screenshots, but we're going to look at sample size and power calculations. And actually, this isn't from this year's hypothesis testing lecture now, because Paul gave it for you all last week instead. But I'm going to talk about an example of cholesterol in hypertensive men. Let's say you have data on 25 hypertensive men. Mean is 220 for their total cholesterol. And you have a sample standard deviation of 38.6. If I go out and I look in national population data, 20 to 74-year-old male population, the mean serum cholesterol is 211 with a standard deviation of 46. So their standard deviation in the population is actually much higher than in my little sample. Not common, but that happens. The question is, my hypertensive men, is their cholesterol different from the average population? Now, it could be, because sometimes as we're treating hypertension, we're treating a lot of other things, including hypercholesterolemia. So we're going to calculate the power with the numbers that are given. So what's the power to see a 9-point difference in mean cholesterol with 25 people? This is a question. Is this a single sample or a two-sample test? If I'm comparing to kind of population-level information, this is really a one-sample test. So Russ Lenth has sent up a whole bunch of different software. One's called PiFace. There are lots of different software programs you can use for this, but this is free, and it has a cute cow picture, so how can I resist? He also has some really great FAQs or frequently asked questions and other elements on his website. He also has a view that I deeply agree with, that please don't ask me for post-hoc power. So he has a lovely article on why you shouldn't do post-hoc power. Anyway, you've got this drop-down for what type of analysis you want to do. So let's say you had a two-sample test. Let's say I actually had 25 people that were normal that I pulled out medical records on, 25 people that were hypertensive that I pulled medical records on. I can set up all this information and figure out what my power is. So I can either set my sample size and calculate the power, or I can set my power and calculate my sample size. Let's do it for the one sample test. If I put in my sigma, I put in the true difference of means. If I want 90% power, I need 170 people. I basically have no power with my little sample of 25 to test for any types of difference in cholesterol. But you know, I kind of chose the 9 as a difference because that's what my difference was. But what is a clinically meaningful difference in total cholesterol? What should I be testing as that difference? These are all questions we would ask each other in advance of a study and not afterwards when you come to me and say, I have 25 medical records. This is the data I have. So what's nice about trying to design the study is I can move all these values around. Okay, you can't get 170 medical records. What can you do? What other assumptions can we make? So you can kind of see if it's not tenable at all to do this study or what your trade-offs are. So different study, going back to the two sample, which I meant to put that slide down here. Let's say I have a standard deviation of 2 in each arm, and you may not. Sometimes you have different standard deviations for each study arm. I'm going to run a two-sided alpha 0.05 test, and we'll look at a true difference in means of 1, 90% power, solve for my sample size. So sigma is 2, I say I have equal. I'm going to two-tailed test, not equivalence. I define my alpha. Difference in means is 1. And if I want 90% power and I hit solve for a sample size, it's going to tell me I need 85 in each arm. But you can also make these nice little graphs. So you can say along the y-axis, this tall vertical axis, that's my power. And then I can see for the sample size in a single study arm on my x-axis, how much power, oops, I have, depending on where I am in the curve. So if I only recruit 50 people, what's my power going to be? These are nice curves to put in your IRB applications and your grant applications. So especially if you're asking for money, you can say, listen, if you give me less money and I have fewer people in my study, this is the trade-off that's happening. Are you sure you want me to make that trade-off? So let's talk about dose escalation a little bit. Those, again, remember, we have basic sample size formulas. Most of us live in phase one, phase two. We're not going to use those basic sample size formulas as often. One of the simple phase one types of studies that we do are called dose escalation studies. We're looking many times in these first in human studies with a new compound for something called a dose-limiting toxicity, or a DLT. Now, it might be that this drug or this compound has been used in humans before, but now I'm trying in a different patient group. A lot of these study designs came out of oncology, so they came from the cancer world. We've been modifying them over the years for kind of, you know, less severe illnesses. And there are a lot of different ways to do phase one and phase two studies. But I'm going to go through what's called sometimes the 3x3, or there are a lot of other names, Fibonacci sequence, although it's not a real Fibonacci sequence. But these were kind of the basic models used for several decades for phase one studies, and probably large portion of studies still today use them. But these have been modified in the last couple of decades to a little more sophisticated studies. But I want you to understand kind of like the basement where we all started. So in phase one, you decide on a handful of dose levels. You decide kind of what toxicities are so bad you would stop and you wouldn't give people that dose anymore. So it might be that people die. It might be that, you know, they have uncontrolled vomiting, whatever you want to call it. Usually you use something like the common toxicity criteria. Their AE grading, you say like anything that's a grade 3, a grade 4 AE, something like that. You know, if you have a disease that's not that bad, you are going to be less willing to tolerate adverse events. And then we have some interventions that never cause toxicities, so you've got to figure out something else that you want to measure. Typically what happens in these phase 3, 3x3 designs is at least 3 patients will be treated on each dose level in each cohort. That's where this 3 comes from. This isn't a power or sample size calculation issue. This is, when it comes down to it, how many people are you willing to have on a totally unknown substance and basically kill at any given point in time? That sounds very ugly, and I've said it before, but I think it's really important to understand the gravity of some of the work that we're doing. And sometimes when there's no choice, you put more people on, and you are taking a higher risk. They need to understand those risks, and we'll talk about that more in the next segment of lectures. But important element here is sometimes even though we want to try 3 people in a given dose, we do it 1 by 1. Just in case, you know, 2 people die and they weren't supposed to, there's no reason to try it on a 3rd person. So kind of the old way that we would do this is we would enroll 3 patients. If 0 out of 3 patients have these dose-limiting toxicities, we'd escalate to the new dose. If you saw a dose-limiting toxicity in 1 of the 3 patients, we expanded the cohort to 6, so we added 3 more people to it because maybe it was a fluke, may not be related to this drug that we're giving them. And we would escalate to a new dose if 0 of the next 3 new patients didn't develop that DLT. In other words, only 1 out of 3 at a given, or 1 out of 6 at a given dose developed a dose-limiting toxicity. The idea is that you are trying to work your way to what's called a maximum tolerated dose, or MTD. This is the dose level immediately below the level at which 2 or more patients in a cohort of 3 or 6 experience that dose-limiting toxicity. We're trying to go for a safe dose. Typically, the maximum dosage is pre-specified in the protocol. So we're going to stop at the MTD, or the maximum dosage. This is the big picture. We're going to go through it in steps. So first I enroll 3 people. One of 3 to 4 things can happen. Maybe none of them have a dose-limiting toxicity. One of them, or 2 or 3 of them have a dose-limiting toxicity. Of course, I drink water and my voice gets worse. So, nobody has a DLT. I escalate to the new dose. 1 out of 3 have a DLT. I enroll 3 more people at the same dose. And if none of those new 3 people have it, I escalate. If 1 or more and this new group had the DLT, depending on my risk tolerance, I may stop. But let's say I only had 3 people on that lower dose. I don't really know that much, so what I might do is, in fact, drop down a dose and start over. So what about 2 or 3 people out of my first 3 have a dose-limiting toxicity? You may stop, or I might drop down a dose. Fill in 3 more people at that lower dose, make sure it's actually okay, and I might start over. I might say, well, you know, it was flu season. I did have my flu shot, but it was flu season. These people actually, they were already immune suppressed, and it seemed like they died of influenza. So we kind of want to restart this. We're not so sure how much of this is really due to our therapy. So you have rules. I don't want you to talk yourself out of your rules. You need to think to have reasonable rules in the first place. But sometimes something weird has happened, and you want to kind of plan these different starts. I will also tell you, sometimes this happens on your first dose. You should always have a backup plan to drop down even from your lowest, supposedly lowest dose. Here it is in a nice chart for those of you who prefer the charts. This is actually taken out of something that Peter Thal at MD Anderson did, which is interesting because Peter Thal really doesn't like this design. But the basic idea is how many patients you have with a DLT and the decision you should make. A few thoughts. So if you have 0 and 3 and 0 and 3, you really had to get here through some de-escalation rule that had to have been applied at a higher dose. Again, sometimes if I had 1 and 3 and then 0 and 3, I might escalate unless it was a de-escalation rule that got me to this 0 and 3. But you have to decide what's your risk of a DLT that you're willing to take. Is it, 16, 17%? Or is it 33%? So what's the risk of having that severe adverse event? It may or may not be that severe, depending on how you set your toxicity levels. What percentage of patients are you willing to have that? When you're working with so few patients here, the confidence interval around it is really huge. This is the reason a lot of statisticians now don't use these. They use these different adaptive designs to enroll more people, get more information. But it is important to figure out, if there is nothing available except death, you might be willing to tolerate a lot of toxicity. Or you may say no. So it's important to figure out what percent of toxicity and what toxicities should be your dividing line. So those stars in that previous table, again, you're implicitly in targeting a dose with a probability of toxicity less than or equal to 17%. But if you're going to look at the 2 out of 6, then you're saying you're willing to have an MTD with a probability of toxicity about 33%. Key point in these trials, patients do not go onto the next dose level until all the patients at the previous dose level are beyond the time frame where you plan to be looking for toxicity. Do not tell me you need to keep enrolling them, but they're here. You have to make sure it's safe to put them on the next level. Your patients have to be there. You have to finish analyzing. You have to finish following them. You have to clean their data, analyze their data, and make a decision. Do we escalate? Yes, no. If you do not have the data to decide if you can escalate, you cannot ethically escalate. Again, not a power sample size calculation issue. There are lots and lots and lots of new methods. Almost all of them are better than the method I just told you, but they are also all based on that method. Sometimes in phase one, now I'm randomizing to multiple different arms. I may have various control arms, might be placebo, might be active control. Why? Because if I'm expecting a lot of toxicity, again, I need to have this comparison to figure out, is this additional toxicity because of my new therapy? Or is this my general background rate of toxicity? Especially when I'm dealing with diseases that maybe I don't want to have a lot of toxicity, I want to make sure that they're safer, I might put 6, 15 plus people per arm. Also, if I'm expecting a wide heterogeneity in the effects and the toxicities, I may want to include more people in this phase one layer of work. But there are CRM, Bayesian methods, lots of different methods you can use here.